Welcome to our daily devotional, April 26th, 250 days left in the year. And today, pray for your pastor. We all need your prayers in this day and age. So thank you for your support. And while you're here, click a like or subscribe to the channel, share this with a friend, and let's get into it. Psalm 5, verse 12. For thou, Lord, wilt bless the righteous. With favor wilt thou compass him as with a shield, the shield of faith. And let's get our armor on, ready for today. If you want to read the Bible in the year, 2 Samuel chapter 23 and 24, and in Luke chapter 19, verses 1 to 27. Here's some thoughts for today. Happiness is not in our circumstances, but in ourselves. It is not something we see like a rainbow or feel like the heat of a fire. Happiness is something we are. Godliness with contentment is great gain. If you really want something, you can figure out how to make it happen. Other people have done it. You can do it too. Those who encourage others appeal to love. Those who judge others appeal to fear. Here's some motivation for today. Peace, like charity, begins at home. On this day in history, in 1928, Madame Tussauds Waxworks Museum opens to the public. 1962, in a joint U.S.-British venture, the first international satellite is launched from Cape Canaveral in Florida. And in 1964, two African nations merged to form the new country of Tanzania. In 1966, the European premiere of the film Dr. Zhivago, starring Omar Sharif, opens in London. In 1986, the worst nuclear disaster in history happens in Chernobyl. Here's your personal story for today, Matthew 28:6. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. And we'll look in references all the way chapter 28. Verses 1 to 15 of Matthew 28. Second century Christian writer Justin Martyr wrote a book in which he defended the faith against the arguments of Thryphro, a Jew. In his dialogue, Justin accused, "You have sent chosen or ordained men throughout the world to proclaim that a godless and lawless heresy had sprung up from one Jesus, a Galilean deceiver whom we crucified. But his disciples stole him by night from the tomb where he was laid when unfastened from the cross, and now deceive men by asserting that he has risen from the dead and ascended into heaven." A century after Jesus' death and resurrection, it appears that that lie manufactured by the Pharisees was still in circulation. You take a look at that in verse 14. The religious leaders had remembered Jesus' prophecy of resurrection and asked every precaution be taken so that the body would not be stolen. The power of Rome sealed the tomb. Guards were set, but that wasn't enough. As we know, the angel appeared and the stone was rolled away. Well, following the resurrection, Jewish leaders bribed Roman guards to spread the lie. The soldiers, who could have been severely punished for their negligence, probably reported to the Jews out of fear. To believe that the same disciples who had fled somehow gained the courage to commit a serious crime, it makes no sense. Not to mention that sleeping soldiers could not have witnessed the crime. Again, the people have to believe whatever they wish. There are a lot of people that believe in the flat earth society and a lot of different conspiracy theories that go around. There's always this or always that. But the change in the disciples is one of the biggest proofs of the resurrection. But right after he got crucified, Peter, John, James, they're going to sneak in there and steal the body. Come on. The first witnesses to the resurrection were women, and they had remained faithful to the news. He has risen. They responded with fear. They rejoiced because their master was alive. They obeyed the angel's instructions, hurrying to share the good news with the remaining 11 disciples. When Jesus himself appeared to encourage them, they bowed at his feet in worship and humility. The benefits of the resurrection are the foundation of our faith. Without it, what are we doing here? We're wasting our time. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit proves Jesus' sovereign power over life and death. You can experience that in your life and know for true that everything that is written happened. And we've got lots of evidence, more proofs of the resurrection than of a lot of other historical figures. And so we know that he has been declared as the one and true Son of God. Here's some devotional thoughts for today. Have you ever received an email or a text from a friend and they're on holidays and they're recounting the amazing events, the sand on the beach, or maybe they're on a ski hill enjoying the snow or whatever it is around about them? You know, has anybody ever told you about the vacuuming of the carpets or, you know, taking out the rubbish at the resort? Not likely. So an online publication called the Journal of Mundane Behavior says that these routine events, they fill most of our lives. Let's face it. It's not always lying on the beach or skiing down the mountain or ripping behind a boat on skis or any of these fun extreme events that we might enjoy. So the managing editor, a sociologist, says every day is valuable since we spend nearly 60% of our lives doing things like, well, traveling to work, shopping for groceries. We don't often consider the Apostle Paul's ordinary days, but he wrote, but in all things, approving ourselves as ministers of God in 2 Corinthians 6:4. All things included not only the harsh persecution, but also needs, sleeplessness, purity, kindness, love, and other everyday experiences. Many people overlook God's capacity to bless us, even though we are washing the car or doing the dishes. All living actions can be blessed by God. And remember, in the midst of those mundane things, he's actually there. So let's live our lives today to the fullest, because it is an important ordinary day and the Lord is with us. Now, what about the cares of the world? Mark 4:19 says, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and the lusts of other things entering in choke the word and become unfruitful. Let's be truthful. We hear the word when it's preached. We say we read the Bible and we study the word while you're here. So you're obviously doing the right things. But do we practice the word? And the cares of the world creep in before us, as we've talked about, the sower and the seed. The weeds tend to choke up around us. Could be the new car. Hey, I just bought a new car. I wish I had one like it. And whether you can afford it or not, you go right out and you try to do it. Maybe you go out and you get that brand new phone, that brand new big screen TV. And are we careless hearers? Does it go in one ear and out the other? Do we realize that without the word, we are unarmed? That's the sword of the Spirit, is the word of God. And we will be unable to defend ourselves against the enemy when he comes. And trust me, he will come. He already is there, and he's trying to deceive some people even now as we speak. So the enemies are like some predatory birds. They go around hunting on the roads, looking for some animal that didn't make it, the vultures. In that same respect, Satan goes around waiting to see who are the careless hearers who just let the word go in, but they never do a thing with it. They hear it on Sunday and they go out their merry way Monday through Saturday, and he's watching, waiting for them to get hit. So let's be more careful and adhere to God's word, to follow his precepts, to attend to his commandments, and to heed his warnings. Let's not attend to worldly affairs and then forget that he wants us attending to our souls. We should watch for the Lord's return, pray continually, and worship him in spirit and in truth. And don't let the worldly things hinder your attending to your soul's needs and the needs of others. And, you know, the fellowship of the saints is probably the best focus of all. That's all we have for today. Got a couple of fun facts to finish off. Subscribe to the channel. Share this with a friend. Let's get the people joining us in this fun devotion each day for 10 minutes. Did you know that gorillas sleep as much as 14 hours per day? And on average, dogs have better eyesight than humans, although apparently they're colorblind. Here's your closing thought. Lord, remind me that I work for you and that I have already been paid for the job I am about to do, bought and paid on the cross of Calvary. I have a joke. A shepherd was herding his flock in a remote pasture when suddenly a brand new BMW appeared out of the cloud of dust. The driver, a young man in a brand new suit, Gucci shoes, Ray-Ban sunglasses, a YSL tie, leaned out the window and asked the shepherd, "Hey, if I could tell you how many sheep you have, will you give me one?" Well, the shepherd looked at the yuppie and, gazing at his flock, calmly answered, "Okay." The yuppie parked his car, grabbed his handheld GPS, whipped out his iPhone, surfed to the NASA website, entered the GPS data, brought up a recent ultra-high-resolution satellite photo, transferred it to Photoshop, exporting it to an image processing facility in Hamburg, Germany. Within seconds, his iPhone had the email notifying him that the image was processed and his data stored in an SQL database on a network server nearby. He downloaded the data into the DBC-connected Excel spreadsheet, ran statistical analysis, transferred the results to Word, outlined it, massaged the outline, then OLED it to a short PowerPoint presentation, which he showed to the shepherd. And it read simply 1,586. "Oh, that's right. I guess you could have a sheep." Well, the young man selected an animal and loaded it into the BMW's trunk. The shepherd then asked him, "Well, now, hang on a second. If I can name your profession, can I have my sheep back?" Well, the man said, "Okay, sure, why not?" Without a moment's hesitation, the shepherd said, "You're a consultant." "Well, that's right," said the yuppie. "Now, how did you know that?" "Yeah, well, it's easy. You showed up here, even though nobody called you. You expected to get paid for an answer I already knew to the question I never asked, and you don't know a damn thing about my business. Now give me back my dog." That's all I got. Thanks for coming. God bless, and we'll see you tomorrow.